Hello and welcome to the prize winner announcement of the 2020 Queen Mary Wasafiri New Writing Prize. I'm Emily Mercer, the assistant editor and prize runner at Wasafiri magazine, and I'm just going to briefly introduce the prize overall before handing you over to Khadija Cisse and this year's fantastic judging team. The prize was founded in 2009 to support new writers, that is, writers who haven't published a book in their chosen genre, from around the world with no limits on age, nationality, gender, race. With the help of some really generous partners, we've recently been able to increase what the prize can offer to the winners. So now winners receive £1,000 each, which makes a real difference for new writers, we hope, which is thanks to support from Queen Mary University of London and from Routledge. And all the shortlisted writers now get a meeting with Nikesh Shukla of the Good Literary Agency to talk about their career progression. And they have the chance to have mentoring with the Literary Consultancy as well. So on top of those career development options, we publish our shortlist online and our winners in the magazine. Do look out for that in our spring issue 105, where you'll be able to read the work by all the winners shortly announced. The prize has grown every year, but this year had a massive growth spurt, reaching 1,600 entries across fiction, life writing and poetry categories, which means that our shortlist are in the top less than 1% of entries from 64 countries around the world, which is such a huge achievement for the whole shortlist and a testament to their global brilliance and relevance. We want to thank everyone who entered and who shared word of the prize. We loved reading this incredibly rich and varied pool of work. Every year there are entries that totally surprise us, and I hope everyone watching will consider entering again next year and knocking our socks off again. So on that note, I'm going to hand you over to Khadija Cisse, our chair of the judges this year. She's going to speak briefly about this year's prize specifically and take you through the awards in each category presented by each judge. Khadija is a powerhouse of publishing. She's a PhD doctoral scholarship student researching Black British publishers and Pan-Africanism. She's a publisher at Sable Lit Mag, publications manager for Inscribed People Tree, editor of several anthologies, has published a poetry collection, Irki, and co-founded Mboka Festival in Gambia. Khadija has received awards and fellowships for work in the creative arts and her research, and has judged several prizes. So over to you, Khadija.
Okay, thank you, Emily. So greetings, everyone, and thank you for joining us for the prize giving announcement, what really is a very special prize. And I didn't realize just how special it was until I was asked to judge it this year, until I was asked to chair the judges this year, 2020. And it's special because when people are entering, they're up against other contributors, other writers from, it could be from any country in the world, basically. So the difficulty for us was that the entries encompass such a broad range of experiences and styles. It's hard to know what to decide on how you select them. Because the writers, you have to think about how the writers have expressed themselves, how they've created an emotional stirring for the reader, as well as obviously the content, and how they've made it memorable for those who are reading it. So the Wasafiri Prize is also special and important, not only for the reasons I have just mentioned, but because Wasafiri as a magazine is over 35 years old. It is like the premier magazine for writers of African and Asian descent, at least in the UK, to be able to publish new work in, to publish their working. So it's very important. It was a wonderful experience to be able to read the work that came in, but also a frustrating one. Not only because we could only select one winner, but also because there's clearly something there that caught the judges' attention. So we really felt that we needed to at least select somebody we could highly recommend that would signpost to them that they are a very special writer and that we would like to see more of their writing and for them to keep writing. So we have had a really, really stellar lineup of judges, which increases how special it is to be able to get such judges to look at new writers' work. And we're going to hear from them now, and they're going to introduce their category of the work that they judged and talk a little bit about the category of work that they read and announce who the winners are. So that's going to be great. So the first judge we're going to hear from is the judge of the Fiction Prize, who this year was Simon Fosser. Simon Prosser has been the publishing director of Hamish Hamilton and Penguin Books since 1997. He is a trustee of the Arts Foundation and the Future Library, and until recently, he was chair of the Civil Liberties Trust. He is also co-founder of the Port Elliot Festival and the literary magazine Five Dials. Authors he's worked with, and you're going to recognize at least one of these, Bernardine Evarista, Marlon James, Zadie Smith, C.L.R. James, Arundhati Roy, Tanasai Coates, Noam Chomsky, Yiyun Lee, Moshin Hamid, Ali Smith, Pat Barker, Susan Sontag, Kiran Desai, and Helen Habila. He's also recognized in the Museum of Color as a person of letters due to the absolute groundbreaking work and the support that he's given writers of color, just such as some of the ones I've just mentioned. So I'm handing over to you, Simon.
Thank you, Khadija, for that lovely introduction. As you said, it was such a pleasure helping to judge this prize. I was really knocked out by the range of the work, by the sheer variety of the styles of writing I was able to read, by the incredible breadth and diversity of the voices that I encountered while working on this. And I loved it, I must say. I had no real idea what to expect. As it was all new to me, and it was all fresh, and it was all exciting. It was very, very hard, actually, reaching a final decision, because, you know, as you've hinted, there's a wealth of such a wealth of writing there. How do you decide? And I was greatly helped by my fellow judges, who you're going to meet in a minute, in reaching a final decision. So I was a judge of the fiction category, and what I'd like to do now is just read the shortlist in full, because everyone on this list absolutely deserves recognition. So bear with me while I read the shortlist. The shortlisted writers were Veronique Bicca for The Benevolence of a Raincoat, Lola Olufemi for Red, Aparna Surendra for Friends from Home, Sharma Taylor for How You Make Jamaican Coconut Oil, and Adam Smith for Holding On. It was a very, very, it's very tough to reach a final conclusion on this. And in fact, what we decided is that we did, rather than just pick a single winner, we wanted to award a highly commended prize as well. So we've awarded highly commended to Adam Smith for Holding On. Congratulations, Adam. A fantastic story. And I think, you know, if anyone reads it, they'll see what he's done is so interesting. In essence, it's two people across two time eras, and they meet in the past and they meet in the present. And it's also foregrounds and counterpoints to pandemics, the AIDS pandemic and the current COVID-19 pandemic. And I thought it did this with great tenderness but toughness. It was surprising, it was sharply visual, and it absolutely had something to say. And the boldness and confidence of it was something that impressed all of us. So congratulations to Adam for that. But of course, we had to pick one winner, and really this story just totally leapt at me and gripped me from the first moment. That the winner is Sharma Taylor for her story, How You Make Jamaican Coconut Oil, which is a story that does tell you how to make Jamaican coconut oil, but does a lot more besides. And I just thought, with enormous vigor and zest and skill, it introduces you to a voice, to a setting, to a family, and it does it in a way that in six pages it's very hard to do that, but she does it absolutely beautifully, framed by this actual recipe, and you discover why the actual recipe is there. What this recipe is going to do and going to do for the people in the story. So it's just terrific, and many congratulations, Salma. I'd love to read more of your writing, and I hope we get a chance to communicate one day. But many congratulations. And now we're going to have a short reading from Sharma's story.
We now have Leonie Ross reading an extract from our winning story, How You Make Jamaican Coconut Oil by Sharma Taylor. Our guest reader, Leonie Ross, is an award-winning novelist, short story writer, editor, and academic. She's been described by the Times Literary Supplement as a master of detail. Her latest book is Come Let Us Sing Anyway, published by People Tree Press in 2017. Leonie is also editing the first Black British speculative fiction anthology for People Tree. Her next book that's coming out is her new novel, One Sky Day, that will be published in April 2021 by Faber and Faber. Thank you, Leonie.
Sharma Taylor. Sharma Taylor in the room. Mirza, you win. This is what you win with. How to Make Jamaican Coconut Oil by Sharma Taylor. Taken from page 38 of the Old Time Jamaica Recipe Book. You will need 2 very dry coconut, about 1/4 pint of water. This gives about 1/4 pint of oil. Method. Grate coconuts. Some of your fingernails and the tip of your finger will get grit off too. Add water and knead for about 6 minutes to work out the coconut milk. Strain and add about 1.5 teaspoon of lime juice and a pinch of salt. Let it stand for 12 hours. By the second hour of the mixture standing, Freddy going come in at the kitchen before him leave for the betting shop, and because him sat down in frisky, him going try to fill you up. Allow him to pinch your bottom. Not too much, because you don't have time for waste today. You have bread pudding, potato pudding, and coconut drops to make for the woman's meeting at church tomorrow. You didn't meet Freddie in Coronation Market, where your mother used to sell mango, banana, oranges. You was a young girl then. Freddie just a boy. Him used to push a handcart. Him would carry the produce from the market truck to the vendor's stalls and carry purchases from the vendor's stall to buyers, cars, or the bus stop. Freddy body did have an electric charge. So when touching doorknobs, gates, or telephones, him shudder like him a get epileptic fits, which is why people sometimes call him by the nickname Fitz, and why you did feel a shock when him hold your hand that first time. You feel that shock now, all these years later, when him kiss your cheek and caress the small of your back. You know him going leave the betting shop, go to the track, and then the rum bar. If him win and ask them, him will celebrate the win by spending every cent buying drinks for everybody like your name, Big Shot. If him unlucky, him will drown him sorrows at the bottom of quarts of white rum. In the fifth hour, Andrian will come in and sigh because of our worthless boyfriend, Chocho, who for real name you often forget because everybody been calling him Chocho for so long, sometime not even his own mother remembers she name our child Alfonso. If Chocho beat her up again, it's likely you will know by how she carry herself. If she leaned to her left side and hiding the left side of her face from you, then that mean him did give her a good box with him right hand and push her down the step of him mother house. You don't say nothing. But you wonder how your one girl child could be so fool for make man slap her up and your blood boiling like coconut milk in rice and peas. But the last time you get yourself involved, she same one team up with church against you and tell if you come out to them yard like you is a common thief, dog or fowl, and you and Andrea never talk for 6 months, except true Freddy, cause that child love our father like cook food.
So congratulations again, and thank you to Wasafiri for including me in this. I really, really enjoyed it. And now back to Khadija.
Thanks for that, Simon. You just really want to make me read that piece all over again, really, because it really was a joy. And hearing that again, it really made me realize that we made the right choice for the winner. Thank you. So now we're going to go over to Ida Adamariam, who was the judge for the life writing. And we are going to hear a little bit about how she found reading those pieces, and then she will notify us of the winner. But let me just tell you a little bit about her, a totally amazing woman. Her first book, The Wife's Tale, was a finalist for a Governor General's Literary Award and won both a Royal Society of Literature Gerwood Award and the 2019 Royal Society of Literature Ondaatje Prize. She's worked as an editor at Harper's Magazine in New York, at the National Post in Canada, and is now a senior feature writer and commissioning editor at The Guardian newspaper, writing on everything from the hostile environment to new poetry and fiction, major political figures to classical literature. She's currently a judge for the International Booker Prize 2021. So I'm now just going to hand you over to Aida Adamariam. Thank you.
Thank you, Khadija. So one of the things I like about life writing is just how broad the remit is. It can be memoir, biography, any combination of the two, and how varied the ways are in which it can be achieved. You know, from poetry and song to prose that reads like fiction, or the traditional cradle to grave account of a life. Reading for this prize, and I really love the range, the global range as well as the range of I thought that was incredibly special. Only underline those possibilities while also reminding me how often life writing arises from the need to describe, and by describing to understand what, for want of a better word, I call the sort of big moments in life. So I found I was reading quite a few accounts of being at the bedside of a dying relative or friend, of caring for someone who is very ill, of navigating the nuances of gender identity, of sexual assault and its lifelong aftermath, or of making a life in a different language far from home. So much of it was really striking and moving. But I guess by the time I was reading for the shortlist, I was looking for other things as well, for the consistency of structure, for insight, for the expression of insight, for something that was fresh or an unusually put and then stayed in your mind afterwards as feeling true. I think all of the pieces in the shortlist fulfill all of those things and more. I am just going to read the shortlist, which is American Blue by Michael Millay. When You Think I'm Hurrying You, But You're Taking an Eternity Over Every Damn Thing by Minifreda Grubetsky. Egress by Nauman Khalid. Seamless by Sharanya Deepak. And Slow Motion by Ellie Slee. There was a highly commended, judges came to a highly commended decision in this category also. And the one that we highly commended in this life writing category had a voice that was utterly confident and utterly its own. It is stylish, highly structured, tightly structured, and completely present. The reader can feel and see everything described, almost as if they could reach out and touch it or even have a chat to the characters involved. The highly commended prize in the life writing category goes to Minifreda Grubetsky for When You Think I'm Hurrying You, But You're Taking an Eternity Over Every Damn Thing. I guess we had to have a winner, but again, it was tricky. But the thing about this winner is that it repaid rereading, and that's an unusual thing actually, and it's really, really worth a great deal. Every time you read it, you can see something slightly different in it. The insight seemed hard won, both in life and in writing, which is also an unusual thing. It describes a fragmented state of being, the result of trauma, but takes the unusual step of focusing on how that plays out in later daily life, the subtle ways in which it can undermine happiness. It was quiet, but it stuck in my mind as saying something important and true. The winner is Seamless by Sharanya Deepak. I'm going to read a couple of paragraphs from it. It's a standing joke among those who know me that I don't like to give hugs. Try it, my friend said, one day at dinner, to a table full of people I had known for years. Somebody appeared behind me, tried to clasp me from the back as I winced and shrank, concave and awkward, wriggling out of the person's grip, asking everyone to stop. See, my friend said, told you, she doesn't like being touched. My inability for physical intimacy is a sort of anecdote. Like people are known for their ability to mimic movie stars, wiggle their ears, or roll their tongues inside their mouths to make a funny noise. It wasn't always like this, I would think, when my toes shriveled and my hair pushed back, my shoulders shivered if anybody put their arm around me. I would think back to when I was a little girl and I used my legs to climb up a tree to tattle on my older cousin. I would carve out the memory of when I swam across a lake with a friend I had made, my arms strongly pushing water behind me as I bounded towards her. I would think of a night when I had walked home barefoot after forgetting my shoes at a party at which I had watched as a person I loved laid himself in someone else's arms. I would remember always when I was 7 years old and my foot was caught in a bicycle as I sat on the hard metallic seat and listened to my mother scream in panicky Tamil, watching bits of my heel drop to the ground. My body, through pain and joy, had belonged to me. These were times when I had lived inside it, our seams tied in together at the ends. But somewhere, somehow, I remember thinking, on the day I wriggled myself out of a person's grasp at dinner as everyone chuckled, we had parted ways. Congratulations, Sharanya. And congratulations also to Minifreda, Michael, Nauman, and Ellie. Thank you so much for your contributions. We enjoyed reading them very much. Congratulations.
Thank you so much, Ida. That was a lovely reading, and I'm sure then now people will understand one of the reasons why it had to be selected. So now we're going to move over to hear what the poetry winners were. But first of all, I'm going to tell you about our wonderful judge who has just been really steaming through the poetry world recently. But he's taken work to get there. So that's why the poets in the shortlist hopefully will understand the work they need to go to do to get to where Raymond is today. Raymond Antrobus is the author of three poetry collections, Shapes and Disfigurement, To Sweet and Bitter, and The Perseverance. The Perseverance has gone on to receive several accolades. In 29, he became the first ever poet to be awarded the Rathbone Folio Prize for best work of literature in any genre. The Ted Hughes Award, a Sunday Times Young Writer of the Year Award, and the Guardian Poetry Book of the Year 2018, as well as the PBS Winter Choice. He's the recipient of fellowships from Carvey Canem, Complete Works 3, and the Gerwood Compton. Raymond is a founding member of Chill Pill, which is a series of spoken word events, and Keats House Poets Forum. He is also an ambassador for the Poetry School. So I'm just handing over now. Please give the announcements and tell us about the prize, the poetry prize, Raymond. Thank you.
Hi, thank you, Khadija. Thank you so much for having me on this panel of esteemed judges. This has been an honor and also a challenge, a real challenge to choose our winners. It was so interesting looking at, you know, considering everything that's happening in the world. It was, yeah, kind of to be in that kind of privileged position of seeing where a lot of people's minds are at, what a lot of people are writing poetry wise. And we had a lot of poems, not so many. You might think there would be loads of like polemical, political poems, but actually there was a lot of family poems, a lot of tender poems, So choosing wasn't easy. But we did have to make a choice. I'm going to read out some of the shortlists. So we had Dear Sabrina by Rebecca Braid. We had Bone Journey by Rupam Bowney. We had Black Says by Joshua Idahim. We did have a commended, which was a poem. When it came to all of us, all of the judges had a say in all of the categories, actually. And we wrestled with this. We even went back and forth between the winner and the commended, but we ended up with Cutting Water by Emily Pitchard being the commended, and the winner going to Conventional Wisdom by Yasmin Seal. So just before I read this poem, A Conventional Wisdom, this made me think in some ways of a Scottish poet called Edwin Morgan, who was this really playful, experimental poet. He has this one particular poem called 14 Variations and 14 Lines, and it's the same 14 words said in 14 different ways. I mean, this poem is doing a similar thing of kind of taking a saying and then creating images and remixes of meanings. And this poem, of all the poems that were submitted this year to the Wasafiri Poetry Prize, it was singular. This was the only poem that chose this as this kind of playful, detached, yet joyful, yet interesting form. And as the judges have said about the other categories, about what are the poems that stay with you, there's just a couple lines that I found staying with me days after reading this poem. So this is Conventional Wisdom, which is an Arabic saying translated 20 ways. The Arabic saying, which, forgive me, I know I'm going to butcher it, but I'm going to have a go. It's Al-Shir Diwan Al-Arab. Who knows how badly and comically I butchered that Arabic saying. I don't speak Arabic. Poetry is the record of the Arabs. The air of poetry is Arabs collected. Good poetry is a list of Arabs. To speak in verse is to remain in Arab memory. To surpass another poet is the Arab odyssey. Knowledge is the Arab living room. Feeling is what Arabs call the office. Falsehood is the Arab court of justice. Noticing is the Arab account book. Reckoning is the Arab reckoning. Being awake is where Arabs rest their heads. Being aware is how Arabs mythologize. Plants are Arabs immortalized. Trees are the Arab board of advisors. Vegetation is the Arab Chesterfield. Saffron is, for Arabs, stray poems gathered. Fur is the Arab sofa. What grows on the body is the Arab saga. Bristles are a gathering of Arabs. Hair is the Arab archive. And I remember we were talking for so long as well about this idea of like this closing line of hair is the Arab archive. And hair is this obviously very kind of contentious, loaded image for particularly for writers of color and particularly for Black women and people. Like how it's this kind of catalyst of all of this history. And Hair is the Arab Archive just sounded like a project that I wanted to be involved in. And so the way that when I read this poem, it just got me thinking and asking myself questions which I'd never asked myself before. And I think that's one hallmark of a good poem. It's in conversation with you, is challenging you, is asking you to go deeper, to think more about history, think more about language, to think more about who we are. And I think this poem does all of that, and with such joy and skill and originality.
Thank you. Cool. Thanks, Raymond. Thank you. Just hearing you read the poem and talk about it again, in that, again, it kind of says again what Simon was saying about freshness. The freshness of material that came through And we heard that too. People even read that even more when they read Seamless too, because Ida only just gave you a really little bit of a taste of it. Wait until you get into that. And it just really, all of these pieces really enveloped all of the judges, and that's why they're the winners. So in closing, I would just like to thank the judges once again. It's just been an honor and a pleasure working with you. I think we did a great job. I think we did. I know we did. We did a great job there. Big up to all the shortlisted writers. Please, please keep writing. You're doing wonderful, wonderful things with your words. If you didn't win this time, you may very well win the next time. So please, please keep writing and keep entering. As Raymond says, Wasafiri and other prizes, they're out there. Even bigger congratulations to the winners who each win £1,000, which helps every writer. So thank you to, and congratulations to Sharma Taylor for How to Make Jamaican Coconut Oil, Sharanya Deepak for Seamless, and Yasmin Seal for Conventional Wisdom. We so look forward to seeing more of your work in the future. Thank you.
Wow, thanks so much, Khadija, and thanks to all the judges and to our fantastic guest reader, Leonie Ross. It's wonderful to hear those pieces slightly read again and to hear you congratulate the whole shortlists. Hearing those pieces read and hearing the whole process of judging discussed again today reminds me of how incredibly special it is to have leaders in the field like this, reading and paying really close, careful attention to new writers who are really at the beginnings of their careers. And that's such a precious thing, and really focuses on what the prize is here to do. That's it from us, really. It's just left to me to thank you and the judges again, Raymond Antrobus, Ida Edamariam, Simon Prosser, Khadija Cisse for chairing. To say thank you to our funding partners, Queen Mary University of London and Routledge. Thanks also to partners, the Literary Consultancy and the Good Literary Agency. And a special thanks to Leonie Ross for joining us for the event today and bringing How You Make Jamaican Coconut Oil to life so wonderfully. The 2021 Queen Mary Wasafiri New Writing Prize will open in January, and we want to read all of your work. Please submit. You can sign up to our newsletter or follow us on here or on social media to be informed when the prize opens, and all those links are below the video. Look out for Wasafiri in the spring, when we'll be publishing the full works of the winning writers in our magazine. If you can't wait that long for more Wasafiri, you can buy our latest issue, Writing Whiteness, from the website, or pre-order our winter special issue, Human Rights Cultures, which focuses on South-South connections and conversations, and on four post-conflict countries, particularly Rwanda, Kenya, Colombia, and Argentina, bringing together literatures that follow in the wake of war. You can also subscribe now for a year of Wasafiri to get those issues I mentioned and the winning writers issue. Or you can subscribe with a rolling subscription and get every Wasafiri we ever publish, which does seem like probably the best option. To celebrate you being here today and to congratulate the winners, we're offering a £5 voucher for any purchase on the website. That code is below the video. So do get yourself a half price magazine or a discount on your subscription, and support fantastic new writers and writing like the work we're celebrating today, and stay up to date on the best of new work in international contemporary literature. Thank you all for watching. Please join me again in raising a glass or a mug or a fork, depending on what time it is for you in the world right now, to this year's fantastic judges and chair, to our funders and partners, to the hundreds of people around the world who entered the prize and who will carry on writing and submitting and being read and being heard, to our phenomenal top 1% shortlist, and again, finally, to the winners of the 2020 Queen Mary Wasafiri New Writing Prize, Sharanya Deepak, Yasmin Seal, and Sharma Taylor. We're so looking forward to continuing to work with you, to publishing you, to championing your growing, exciting careers well into the future. So from me and from everyone at Wasafiri, congratulations.